On April 7, 1814, the British sailed up the Connecticut River with the hopes of destroying one of America's biggest shipping ports on the East Coast. This raid would turn out to be one of the worst naval losses in U.S. history. In 1814, the War of 1812 had been raging for 2 years. The Native Americans, led by one of the greatest warriors of their time, Tecumseh, were trying to stop the U.S. from moving westward into their land. The British troops based in Canada were trying to stop the U.S. from taking their land in Canada. The U.S. had been continuously attacking the Canadian border for 2 years from various points. All have failed, but the U.S. wouldn't give up. On the Eastern Front, the British had been blocking the Eastern Seaboard, including the Long Island Sound, so America could not trade with the French, who the British were fighting due to Napoleon's attempt to control Europe. The President, James Madison, had commissioned privateers to fight the British blockade and tried to disband it. The British worked to find the source of the ships, and one of the main ports was Essex. But then Jeremiah Holmes tried to torpedo the British warship La Hogue in an attempt to free Stephen Decatur and his squadron from a British blockade. The torpedo blew up prematurely. Even though La Hogue did not get damaged, the British were still angry. The British started patrolling the Long Island Sound very closely. The next day, the British found an odd man rowing a skiff with oars just outside of Old Saybrook. The British were suspicious, so they interrogated him and threatened to kill him. The British called him Torpedo Jack. He ended up telling them about Essex and also said that he was going to guide them to Essex, or at the time known as Petitar. Richard Coote of the HMS Boar and 136 Marines and sailors were sent to stop the privateering at Essex. On April 7, 1814, at around 9:45 p.m., the British sailed up the Connecticut River. At around 10:30 p.m. at Lynn Point Lighthouse sent to warn Essex. The British arrive at Old Saybrook Point and find Fort Fenwick abandoned. They continue to sail up the river. On April 8, 1814, 3:30 a.m., Captain Coote and 136 Marines and sailors arrive in Essex. They send rowboats full of Marines to Main Street. The militia in Essex fired back with small arms fire and small cannon fire, but ceased firing right after the British returned fire. The British made an offer: don't attack us and we will leave your property untouched. The British began to torch Petitot's vast naval fleet. Ships were attempted to be salvaged, but it was too late. They sunk. The British also stole all the shipbuilding materials and burned the locations where the ships were being built because they didn't want any more privateering ships to be created. They also stole all the rum supply and rope supply from the chandlery. Meanwhile, the local militia was mobilizing to attempt to stop the British from escaping out of the mouth of the river. At 6 a.m., the British discovered more ships in North Cove. They also torched all the ships anchored in North Cove. This is the reason why the British stayed till 10 a.m. At 10 a.m., the British leave and take the young Anaconda and the schooner Eagle with them because they need somewhere to carry the ship materials. Those two ships are Essex's best vessels. By now, the British have destroyed 25 ships in Essex and at North Cove. At 11:30 a.m., the young Anaconda gets beached, and they had to take the supplies from the young Anaconda onto the schooner Eagle and their other ships that they brought with them, and they burned the young Anaconda. After that, Captain Richard Coote decides to anchor the schooner Eagle, and they stopped until it was dark.
At 12 p.m., Major Marsh Ely, the leader of the local militia, sends a messenger to give Richard Coote a letter of surrender. The messenger is on a ship with a white flag, which means he comes in peace. He asks the British to surrender because Major Marsh Ely thinks that the British have no chance of escaping the Connecticut River alive. He gave him a letter, and the letter is addressed to Richard Coote. Here's a segment of the letter. Quote, unquote, "To avoid the effusion of human blood is the desire of every honorable man. The number of forces under my command are increased so much as to render it impossible for you to escape. I therefore suggest to you the propriety of surrendering yourselves prisoners of war, and by that means prevent the consequence of an unequal conflict which must otherwise ensue." End quote. Captain Richard Coote refused the terms, and the messenger sailed away. Captain Richard Coote later said, quote unquote, my reply was verbal and merely expressed my surprise at such summons, assuring the bearer that thought sensible of their human intentions. We set their power to detain us at defiance, end quote. The British waited until it was dark enough, which was around 7 p.m. Captain Richard Coote decided that they needed to be more hidden, so they decided to burn the Eagle. They transferred the materials from the Eagle to their other ships. The British began to run the gauntlet, taking cannon fire from multiple points on both sides of the river. It was hard for the militia to see, so they were basically shooting aimlessly. They passed Fort Saybrook at around 8:30 p.m. They reached the mouth of the river and escaped at around 9 p.m. During the whole battle, they only lost two men, and two of their men were wounded also. The local militia mobilized in Stonington because they knew the British were coming for them next. Then, on August 9th, 1814, a battle issued in Stonington. In the end, the militia emerged victorious. The British raid on Essex turned out to be one of the greatest raids of all time, but it was soon forgotten after the burning of Washington a few months later. But Essex soon recovered and was stronger than it was before, with new larger shipbuilding facilities which led to a much better economy, which then led to the population increasing. Today it is stronger than ever, even though they no longer build ships. But until recently, the raid was forgotten until an old naval commander from Essex went to a meetup in Canada. When he was discussing to a Canadian, he told him he was from Essex. The Canadian naval officer was surprised and went on to tell him that a member of his family participated in the raid, and he gave him a letter from when the militia told the British to surrender. The naval officer took this home to Essex, and this sparked the community to try to find their history. The community immediately began archaeological digs around the base of the Connecticut River and all of Essex. They did not just include Essex, though they searched the whole base of the river to find anything the British or the militia could have shot. This led to information being uncovered. For example, they knew where everything happened. They weren't just going off 200-year-old local legend. People also handed in artifacts like journals and cannonballs. From these artifacts, they learned information like the times of the events. Now in Essex, the raid is famous, and they have a yearly parade called the Loser's Day Parade to celebrate the event and keep it in the public eye. The British raid on Essex had triumph and tragedy because they might have lost all their ships and supplies. They gained the opportunity to redevelop and become stronger than before.
Three gallant ships from England came, freighted deep with fire and flame, and other things we need not name, to have a dash at Stonington. Now safe arrived, they work begun, they thought to make the Yankees run, and have a mighty deal of fun in stealing sheep at Stonington. A Yankee then popped up his head, and Parson Jones our sermon read, in which our reverend doctor said that they must fight for Stonington. Their ships advancing several ways, the Britons soon began to blaze, which put old Williams in amaze, who feared the loss of Stonington. The Ramillies first began the attack, and Nimrod made a mighty crack, and none can tell what kept them back from setting fire to Stonington. Their bombs were thrown, their rockets flew, and not a man of all their crew, though every man stood in full view, could kill a man of Stonington. Their old razee with red-hot ball soon made a farmer's barrack fall, and did a cowhouse sightly maul that stood a mile from Stonington.